Welcome to USPTO's LGBTQ Plus program, Proud Innovation. I'm Sean Wilkerson, Innovation Outreach Program Manager in the Office of Innovation Outreach here at the United States Patent and Trademark Office. I'll be your MC for today's program as we celebrate some accomplished innovators while highlighting some of the programs and services that support the LGBTQ Plus community. Here at USPTO, we embrace diversity and work to bring attention to resources by tapping into the strength of our nation's diversity and increasing the opportunities for all Americans to participate in innovation. We're excited that you joined us for this inaugural program of all LGBTQ Plus members. Our distinguished panelists will share their insight and experience to provide you with valuable knowledge. During today's program, we will be accepting questions by email at innovationoutreach@uspto.gov. We will do our best to get to all of your questions at the end of each panel so we can provide you with information that you need to be successful. If for any reason you get disconnected, you can log back into the program at any time via the link that brought you here. If you miss a portion of today's program, don't worry. We will be posting the presentations online for you to review. That way you can engage and review information with all of our speakers who present today through our website. Now, I have the distinct pleasure of introducing you to a proud member of our executive team who serves as the Chief Administrative Officer for the U.S. Patent and Trademark Office. He's responsible for the delivery of all administrative service support functions for USPTO, including human capital strategy, human resource management, telework policy and programs, facilities management, safety and security, transportation, asset and records management. Ladies and gentlemen, Fred Steckler.
Thank you, Sean, very much. We really appreciate this. And thank you for your leadership here and the work that you do together with the Office of Innovation Outreach to develop programs like this and so many others. So, Sean, it's a pleasure to work with you, and thank you very much. On behalf of the United States Patent and Trademark Office's leadership team, welcome everybody to today's exciting event. And thank you, and a very special greeting to our amazing group of panelists and program facilitators. We really appreciate your time with us, and we are honored by your presence. You know, we've come a long way. As a gay person, the progress made during the last 30 years is nothing less than inspiring to me personally. The Navy that I joined in 1983 actually prohibited my service. But from open military service to marriage equality, I never honestly thought that I would see the progress that we've made. There's still a long way to go, though, in our journey, and I think we can all agree with that. But you know, our community, along with our allies, is vibrant, and as we will see today, resourceful, and inventive, and resilient. So I'm confident as we look forward to the future. You know, it was a real eye-opener when the Office of Personnel Management conducted the Federal Employee Viewpoint Survey in 2019, and they found that throughout the federal government, and including the Commerce Department, that our gay and lesbian bisexual colleagues rated their work experience as markedly less positive compared to those who were straight. In virtually every category, our LGBTQ plus colleagues expressed less satisfaction with their jobs, their feelings of accomplishment, workloads, importance towards the agency's mission, their ability to get promotions, training, and other essential aspects of work that we all take for granted. The survey included 600,000 federal employees, and it really gave us some insight into the work yet that remains ahead of us as a top employer of choice for the federal government. Part of creating a more welcoming environment where people do not feel isolated is recognizing the importance of the accomplishments of our LGBTQ plus colleagues, and certainly in face of the battles that they've all fought, that we've fought, biases, barriers that we've all faced. We've responded at the PTO by promoting the diversity of our own staff. We have a great program. Matter of fact, the first time that I came to the PTO campus was before I was hired here back in the early 2000s. And I happened to just think how fortunate it was. I happened to arrive on Community Day, which is a wonderful celebration of all of our diverse aspects and inclusivity at the PTO. And there was a huge rainbow balloon structure that had been created. And, you know, given my start in the Navy, where I wasn't particularly welcome as a gay person, I was just amazed and realized I'd found the right spot. I just needed to figure out how to come work here. So, and I did, by the way, about 10 years ago. So we have a lot of training programs, as you all know, focused on diversity and of all aspects of diversity, and definitely a number of them targeted towards LGBTQ issues. We also, at the PTO, we recognize days of the year, which are symbolic and important. March 31st, International Transgender Day of Visibility. May 17th, International Day Against Homophobia. October 11th, National Coming Out Day. And then November 20th, the International Transgender Day of Remembrance. And then, of course, December 1st, which is World AIDS Day. With our Diversity Office's Equal Opportunity Employment Strategy, we're expanding our diversity and outreach efforts and are establishing more relationships with LGBTQ plus organizations, such as the LGBTQ Bar Association and the Lavender Law Conference and Career Fair. We exhibit at these events and run employment workshops to help members of our community navigate the complex and challenging federal application and hiring process. Through the work of the USPTO Diversity Program and the Office of Innovation Outreach, we sponsor successful programs for employees, such as the June 2 Out at Commerce panel event, where employees were talking freely about their experiences and how to mentor others. We're also very fortunate to have one of the most established and active LGBTQ plus groups in government. Lambda PTO is one of our 30 officially recognized voluntary employee organizations, and it's one of the oldest, having been established more than two decades ago. I can't tell you how proud we are of Lambda PTO and how active it is with its coffee breaks, film discussions, social gatherings, speaker events, and then this past year and 4 months or so, doing all of that in a virtual environment. Beyond helping people connect, Lambda has been instrumental in providing a voice in our agency's affairs, and even advocating things like flying the Pride flag during Pride Month at our headquarters building. We got an even bigger one this year. So if those of you that are around, please stop by and take a look. And I can tell you, for those of you that have driven by the Commerce building this year, Commerce headquarters downtown, if you haven't done it, I encourage you to do it. There is on the 14th Street side, there is a huge Pride flag, which was lined up right along with the other US flags. Quite a sight to see. And thank you to everyone in our Office of Equal Employment Opportunity and Diversity for your passionate work in expanding the diversity of the PTO workforce and creating a truly inclusive environment, especially today, for your commitment to all of us in the LGBTQ plus community. I'd also like to thank our Office of Human Resources, facilities and conference staffs, and all team members who have been so helpful in making this past year and a half as comfortable and safe as possible, whether it's in a physical environment or a virtual environment. We've all pulled together, and thanks to everyone for everything that you have all done. I can speak for the entire management team at the USPTO in saying that we take great pride in the LGBTQ plus community, your ability to overcome obstacles, willingness to take risks, to create allies, and to promote respect and understanding among us all. So again, we salute all of you who are participating in today's event. We thank you, and you've accomplished so much. We can't wait for the program to get started. And happy Pride, everybody.
Thank you, Fred, and thank you for your leadership in making the USPTO a diverse place to work. And thank you again for being part of today's program. At this time, I would like to ask our panel members for the Inspiring Innovation Panel to make sure your camera and your microphone's on so we can begin our discussion on creating change and building a legacy. Now, Peter Fowler, Senior Counsel for Enforcement here at USPTO, will introduce you to the panel. Peter?
Thank you very much, Sean. And it's really an immense honor and pleasure for me to have the opportunity to moderate this particular panel today with all of you and discuss your work and lives. as a non-scientist, but someone who is really fascinated by all aspects of science and enjoys learning about it, if not practicing it, it's a special delight to moderate this discussion and to learn from all of your collective experience. It's sort of an understatement to say that you're very accomplished scientists, and what you've done is both amazing and beneficial to humanity. I grew up in a household where science on sort of a day-to-day basis was encouraged and explained. My father was an engineering graduate of Bucknell. My mother was a registered nurse anesthetist. I read magazines and articles about anesthesiology and civil engineering and things like that throughout growing up. And when I had questions about why things are, or, you know, my father pointed me to the World Book Encyclopedia that he had purchased for us and said, look it up and read it yourself. You'll learn better that way. So I was exposed to a lot of very practical, everyday sorts of things. I even had a time when I was a substitute teacher and was assigned to teach some science classes. That was a challenge for a political science and English major in college, but I enjoyed it. I want to ask, first I want to just sort of introduce all of our panelists. You have their biographies and their materials it's available to you. And I won't go through all of them there. They're very extensive, but I just want to highlight a few things. Dr. Jay Kiesling, he's the Philomathia Professor of Alternate Engineering at the University of California, Berkeley, in the Departments of Bioengineering and Chemical and Biomolecular Engineering. He's also a senior faculty scientist at Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory and the Chief Executive Officer of the Joint Bioenergy Institute. His educational background, he received his bachelor's degree from the University of Nebraska at Lincoln and his PhD from the University of Michigan, and he did postdoctoral research with Arthur Kornberg at Stanford University. His research is amazing in the area of metabolic engineering especially. He's considered one of the foremost authorities in synthetic biology, and his current research focuses on engineering the chemistry inside microorganisms for production of useful chemicals or environmental cleanup. Certainly something that the world can use a lot of. In the area of biofuels, for example, he's engineered microorganisms to produce hydrocarbons with similar properties to the fuels now derived from petroleum, synthesizing them from plant-derived sugars. That allows for reducing the carbon footprint by minimizing the energy expenditure in sourcing fuel. And recently he demonstrated that a microorganism could be engineered to synthesize and secrete enzymes to depolymerize cellulose into sugars to produce a gasoline replacement, a diesel fuel replacement, and a jet fuel replacement. He's published over 300 papers in peer-reviewed journals and has over 30 issued patents. So we welcome Dr. Kiesling to the panel. Dr. Dirk Trauner, he's the Janice Cutler Professor of Chemistry at New York University currently. His educational background, he studied biology and biochemistry at the University of Vienna. And from 1992 to 95, he studied chemistry at the Free University of Berlin. He completed his diploma under Dr. Johann Mulzer, who he first and subsequently Vienna as an assistant. In 1997, he completed his PhD at the University of Vienna, and he did postdoctorate work at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York. Later, he moved to the University of California in Berkeley, where he was an assistant professor, and later an associate professor with an affiliation to also to the Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory. And from 2008 to 2017, he was professor for chemical biology and genetics at the Ludwig Maximilian University of Munich. He is currently also an adjunct professor of neuroscience at the New York University Grossman School of Medicine and a member of the Science Institute of the Perlmutter Cancer Center. His major areas of interest lies on the functional manipulation of ion channels and CPCRs using synthetic photoswitches, usually azobenzenes, which can be inserted into neurons and other cell types and used to control various biological pathways with light. This is all photopharmacology, and he'll have a chance to talk a little bit more about it later. And last but not least, is Dr. Sean Whalen. He's currently chairman of the Department of Molecular Microbiology at Washington University School of Medicine in St. Louis. He's a well-respected and renowned British-American virologist, and he's particularly well-known for having identified the cellular protein used as a receptor by the Ebola virus, for defining the entry pathway that the rabies virus uses to enter neurons, and identifying the ribosome as a possible target for antiviral drugs. He received his first class honors degree in microbiology and biochemistry from the University of Birmingham and completed his PhD at the University of Reading. His current research, when he joined initially Harvard Medical School's Department of Microbiology and Molecular Genetics, was in the area of virus mechanisms. He was later named of the Department of Molecular Biology and the Marvin Brennecke Distinguished Professor of Microbiology at Washington University. And he's recently been involved in, and his lab has done research in dealing with COVID-19 and SARS virus. So with all of those things in mind, I'd like to turn over to the entire panel and ask a general question, which I'd like any of you to respond to, or all of you to respond to. Can you identify an event or a specific influence in your youth that set you on your career path? Or did the motivation to do the type of work that you all do come later in life?
I can start. Yeah, so there was a specific event. I was probably in my teens and read an article in Newsweek or Time about Genentech starting up. And this would have been in the mid to late 70s. And the article was about all of the people who were applying there for jobs and how exciting this new area of biotechnology was going to be. And it really excited me about engineering biology to accomplish some good goal, and really set me on my path, I think, in the area of engineering biology and synthetic biology.
Dirk, do you have an influence on your path? You're on mute.
Can you hear me now? Yeah. So I was born a scientist. I actually was more interested in the arts as a teenager, and I wanted to become an architect. And I met friends who studied architecture, and I gained this impression that they work these long, long hours for a guy who takes all the credits, and it takes until their mid-30s until they can do their own independent work. Thank God science was so different. So I decided to actually study biology. And started out as a biologist, but then I took a course, a practical course in Vienna on chemistry, which was a requirement for a biologist, and I fell in love with synthetic organic chemistry. And then my then boyfriend moved to Berlin, and the wall fell, and I decided to change fields and become a chemist and live in Berlin, and the rest is history. But it was a rather circuitous pathway. It was not a straight line.
So love did play an influence in the path you took.
As always, life has a tendency to interfere with your grandest designs for your career, right?
True. Sean?
So I think the influence, the thing that I would point to as an influence for me to become a microbiologist was the discovery as a child that microbes were responsible for making things like bread, beer, wine, and cheese, all things which I thought were amazing. And then I discovered that microbes actually cause disease as well, which fascinated me to think that such small organisms could actually kill, in the case of some viruses like rabies, almost completely kill every single person who is infected if left untreated. And so this, I think, encouraged in me a fascination for microbes. And when I went off to college, decided that this was a topic that I would study in detail.
Okay. And I take it you still are interested in the microbes that make the beer and the wine and the cheese.
I try and sample those products as often as possible.
Okay.
So contemplating what to do with the ones that actually can kill you.
Well, there is that. I want to ask a question there, since that sort of provides the opening. Certainly in Europe, perhaps not as much in the United States, there has been over the years quite a movement against genetically modified, you know, food and products. Do you have any views as a scientist about that?
I guess what I would say is that we've been genetically modifying things for a long, long time. The entire process of breeding and selecting for traits amongst plants and amongst yeast that give beer a particular flavor, etc. We've been doing this for a long, long time. I guess what people in Europe in particular, and also parts of the United States, seem to view quite differently is specific genetic engineering of organisms to improve certain qualities of food products. I think there's actually a benefit that we get from those manipulations. And I think to some extent, it's a communication issue where we need to educate the public more about the benefits, in fact, of these processes.
Did science kind of lose that initial communications battle or messaging battle when perhaps the first opponent to GMOs called it Frankenstein food?
I think it's not unique to genetically manipulated organisms. I think scientific change is something that we've always had a communication challenge with. If you think about, I look at this from my own perspective a little bit, but if you think about the development of vaccines, for example, there are some very famous cartoons that were drawn and published in the British press around the time that Jenner was vaccinating people with cowpox to protect them against smallpox. And I think it's just that people are scared of the unknown. And I think we're seeing this right now with some hesitancy amongst people to get vaccinated against SARS-CoV-2, for example. And so I think wherever there is a scientific advance, there's also a need for us to educate the public about the value and the challenges of that scientific advance. A good example being CRISPR technology right now.
How do you sort of account for the difference? I was a fairly young child, but I remember the long lines to get the polio vaccine, in my hometown, and standing in line, and you know, everybody wanted to get vaccinated against polio. But what's changed in the last 50, 60 years from that, you know, situation where there was a broad support, sort of buy-in, if you will, by the community at every level, that getting vaccinated was not just a personal decision, but a community responsibility. You seem to hear that same messaging or that same attitude now. And what's changed that, in your opinion?
So I think there's a couple of things that have changed, one of which was incredibly unfortunate, which was a fraudulent publication that was published by a British physician a number of years ago that suggested measles vaccines were associated with autism in kids. And that turned out to be a fraudulent publication. And despite that, the damage had been done. So again, I think it's a communication issue. In this case, it was a miscommunication issue. And I also think that at the time that the vaccines that were rolled out for poliovirus were introduced, there was a really strong and coordinated campaign at the highest levels of both entertainment and the US government to actually encourage people to get vaccinated. In fact, when I teach students about polio, I used to show a slide of Elvis Presley and the president both receiving their polio vaccines at the same time. And one of my colleagues happened to point out that nobody in the audience anymore knew who either of these two people were because of the age difference. So I guess I've stopped using that slide, but I think it's an example of how we need to engage everybody in educating the public about the value of scientific advances.
For all of you, I mean, in various ways, myself included, we all lived through the 80s and certainly the early 90s of the HIV and AIDS pandemic, if you will. And there was a lot of, I mean, I was a law student in San Francisco at the early stages of it. There was a lot of miscommunication, a lot of fear that wasn't really countered by good scientific, you know, messaging and communication at the beginning of the AIDS crisis. Do we just not learn any real lessons about how to approach new diseases? And there always seems to be these cycles of react fear that humans have with something that's unknown. Do we just never learn how to address that or anticipate it? Anything?
It's a good question. We see history repeat itself many times over. I mean, what hasn't repeated itself with this current crisis is that the government put a huge amount of money and effort behind developing a vaccine, and vaccines were developed in record time. You wonder if the government had put that much money into HIV, if something similar would have been developed quickly.
It's important to remind people how amazing 96 was, right? I mean, in early 96, people died. And if you made it to September, October, you would live, right? And I was right in the middle of that. Like, I witnessed this firsthand. And this was for me one of the most, strange, thrilling times in my life, because you saw what an incredible difference science and innovation can make. And it was absolutely palpable. It was right there. Mm-hmm. I lost a friend in March 96, and the rest would go on and live happy and productive lives.
Yeah. Sean, any thoughts on learning lessons from past pandemic diseases?
I think that what is clearly apparent is that we don't learn the lessons very easily. I don't know what the solution is there. I think perhaps we all need collective therapy as a society that actually helps us from making the same mistakes again and again and again. I think, unfortunately, when things become politicized, it becomes harder too. And I think we saw some of that during this pandemic. So I think that poses additional challenges.
You know, the question you raised about what if things had been different, I can remember the first report out of the CDC calling what later became AIDS, GRID, gay-related immune deficiency. And so that HIV became so associated with the gay, particularly the gay men's community. I mean, yes, it was having an impact, obviously, but somehow was the homophobia behind that also a huge deterrent to really directly addressing the challenges of the disease and finding cures or treatments, in your opinions?
I think it probably had something to do with it. You know, I think it took the government a long time to react, and then at times it didn't want to react. Whereas if you look at the current crisis where it hit everyone pretty much equally, the government was very fast to react. So it probably had something to do with it. But you also have to realize that technology has come a long way in 30 plus years, right? And we have a lot more available to us to fight these crises.
Yeah. So it's also not that the pharmaceutical industry did not respond to the AIDS crisis early on, right? So as much as important Larry Graham and ACT UP and what was to sort of get people going, I think that the unknown, unnamed came to play an equally important role in overcoming this crisis. And some of whom I actually know quite well. And they've never, I don't know whether you've ever read David Francis' book, How to Survive a Plague, which is a really interesting account of the AIDS crisis, and talks about this interplay between government and activism, and a little bit actually also about the science that ultimately found a solution, a way to manage this crisis. Mm-hmm. I can highly recommend it.
Right. Well, picking up on something that you've been quoted as saying, Dirk. You've made the observation that as an organic chemist, you're intrigued by the structural beauty and functional sophistication of organic molecules. That's, when I read that, it struck me as a very poetic observation that maybe many people would not attribute to a scientist. Can you elaborate on that a little bit? Is that your artistic background, exposure, or desires coming through there?
Again, I think the architect in me, the closeted architect in me, speaks here, because I really want to make little things, right? But I want to think of structure and then pour it into matter, right? I think this is one of the most satisfying things a human can do, when you sort of think about something that doesn't exist in material form, and then you make it, be it the Sagrada Familia, or be it a beautiful and functional molecule. And, you know, as an architect, you think about function and form, and as a chemist, especially as a synthetic chemist, and as a virologist, and as a shaper of biochemical pathways, metabolic pathways, you also think about function and form. And this interplay between function and form, I think, is what makes, at least for me, chemistry and science so fascinating.
I see. Yeah, because it seems like certainly viruses are constantly making things and restructuring themselves.
And they're structurally absolutely fascinating, right? If you're into symmetry, as I am, you read the virology literature just for the symmetrical properties of viral capsids and the logic behind it, right? Already noted by Crick, by the way, if you want to package the maximum on information in the minimum of space and building blocks, you have to make an icosahedron. And this was actually predicted before it was proven by somebody who thought deeply about how would I do it if I were a virus.
Yeah,
that's a typical approach thing. So.
As a complete scientific novice in this respect, since I have you on the panel, I have to ask you this question. I know it's a little tangential, but viruses, by scientific reasoning, are not alive. Is that correct? They're not life. But how do they do what they do?
So
any process that's going on there?
So they require a living cell in order to replicate. So they piggyback upon the host's life, but they encode, their genome encodes all of the necessary information for autonomous replication within that given host, which I find fascinating about viruses. Although I have to say some of the lines are being blurred a little bit these days, because some of the extremely large viruses even encode aspects of their own translational machinery. We know that some viruses encode their own polymerases because they don't have access to those of the host, or they need to encode specialized polymerases. And in fact, this was one of the reasons that we have effective therapies against HIV. The drugs target the viral polymerase, the reverse transcriptase, and they also target another enzyme of the virus, the protease. Essentially, viruses are capable of replication only in the context of a host. So wherever there is life, there should also be viruses.
More generally, wherever there's a complex replicating system, there will be a virus, be it a computer code or be it life. This is inevitable, I think.
So they've been around almost as long as we have, or longer, on the planet?
That gets us into an area of speculation and debate. We can talk about the RNA world and whether people view that as the beginnings of life and what happened after we emerged from slime. I think I'll save that for another discussion.
Okay. Jay, when Abraham Lincoln was granted a patent for a device to lift boats over shoals, although he never made any money at it, he never licensed it and never became a commercial success the way you have with your patents, he famously stated that the patent system added the fuel of interest to the fire of genius. Now, you're not only a fairly prolific inventor, but you have quite a few patents to your name for your discoveries and innovations. Did you consider the patent system as a motivator to you in your research, or was it more complicated than that?
I don't know if the patent system is so much a motivator for me. What motivates me to start companies is to get the technology out to people. In my case, the federal government has awarded me a lot of grant money, and that grant money has invented various things. And I feel it's my obligation when I can to give back to the public. And one of the best ways to give back to the public is to commercialize an invention. And so the patent system enables that by protecting it for a period of time, allowing a company to acquire the money to start, and then to commercialize that technology and get it out, and protect themselves so that they can get that money back. And so I feel that the patent system is a huge enabler of our commercialization of discoveries, especially basic science discoveries.
Mm-hmm. Great, thank you. Dirk, Sean, any thoughts on the patent system?
It takes a while to get used to it.
Plays with science?
It takes a while to get used to it. I have to admit that I didn't particularly like writing patents or reading patents when I started my career. I've become a little bit more excited about it recently. So one of the things, for instance, that has motivated me to read more patents is there was an account by Stuart Shriver on the discovery of FK506 or the FK506 rapamycin connection, right? And he actually wrote in this review that he stumbled upon this when he read patents on natural products with bioactivity. And I always wondered, how do these guys find out what natural products really work on? Were they really hot ones? Are they just having advantages because they're consulting for companies? What is it? And what it eventually apparently was in Stuart Shriver's case, which led to a huge world of immunosuppressants, of course, was reading the patent literature. So I can only encourage students to read the patent literature in a very focused way, perhaps, in addition to science and nature and whatnot, because the most exciting new and perhaps even really important stuff is likely to show up first in the patent literature.
Uh-huh. Well, that's good to hear. That it provides that kind of perhaps insight that leads to further. I mean, many, many inventors, patent holders have said that, you know, I think the phrase is something that they stand on the shoulders of giants that came before them in terms of technology and patenting. And the greatest aspect of the US patent system was the publication. That the trade-off that the founders made, the framers made of the Constitution, was that you get the monopoly for a period of time, but you have to share the information with everybody else, with the public. And that provides a basis for others to perhaps, as you say, read the patents and they become inspired or they learn things or think about things to pursue. Sean, it strikes me that many, many medical researchers sometimes would spend their entire life, their entire career, pursuing a single disease and becoming an expert at, you know, trying to find, you know, a cure for something, but focused. It struck me that your breakthroughs in medicine against various deadly viruses are nothing less than, first of all, awe-inspiring, and congratulations. But I suspect that the last year or so, with COVID-19, the SARS virus, has been more than just an interesting pastime academic reading for you, that you've been involved, you know, up to your hip boots, as they would say, in the research and the study and tackling it. What have you been doing in this area this past 16 months or so?
Well, two things. One is I wondered why on earth I timed my new job so badly. Showing up as chair of a department 2 months before you have to sort of close down research labs temporarily because they're not working on COVID and people need to go home and work from home was not what I had in mind for my job. But my own lab began very early, actually, in the pandemic. In fact, the first day that the spike sequence of COVID was published, we began a project to try and develop a vaccine based on the livestock pathogen, vesicular stomatitis virus. And essentially, we used the same sort of approach that was used to make the Ebola vaccine that is licensed for use in humans. And we actually got a long way through preclinical development of that vaccine, including demonstrating efficacy in animal models of disease, and were hopefully looking to find partners to advance further the vaccine candidate. Unfortunately, that didn't turn out to be the case. Thankfully, the RNA vaccines that we now know work so well, along with some of the adenovirus vaccines, were a little bit ahead of us. But nevertheless, that kept my own lab rather busy. And with a number of other things that I was doing at the institution to sort of mitigate the effects of the pandemic and allow research operations to continue, we contributed to a number of additional COVID-related projects.
I see. Was it sort of the same way when you tackled like Ebola which is certainly, at least reputation-wise, a scary virus. I mean, rabies, obviously, measles, others, viruses are not pleasant ones to get. But Ebola, do you have some secret death wish here or something?
I think this was very different to Ebola. First of all, the rapidity with which this virus spread around the globe was just, because it's a respiratory transmitted disease, was just phenomenal. Whereas Ebola requires close contact with an infected individual. And even though we had a really large outbreak of Ebola in West Africa, the total number of people who've been impacted by Ebola virus that we are aware of since the discovery of the virus in 1967 is less than 40,000 people. And that pales in comparison to the number of people who've been killed, even in this country alone, by SARS-CoV-2. We're now in excess of 600,000 people in the US alone. And so I think the urgency with which the entire scientific community started working on SARS-CoV-2 was quite different.
I see. But one thing that the COVID pandemic seems to have clearly underscored is the fact that the whole world is at risk, no matter where a virus emerges, that given transportation, flight patterns, travel, communicate, everything else, that it doesn't take that long to circle the globe and become a major problem for everyone. Is that something that we can build into strategies about the next pandemic when it comes along?
So to some extent, it's complicated by the route of transmission and something called the reproductive value of the virus. So the virus that we know has the highest, it's called an R number. The highest R number that we are aware of is measles. And its R number is somewhere between 12 and 16, which essentially means one individual can transmit to up to 16 other individuals who can then transmit to 16 more individuals. That number for SARS-CoV-2 is actually much closer to one. It's about 1.5. And I think even for the most infectious of the new variants, it is not significantly higher than that. It hovers around 2. And so to some extent, we're incredibly fortunate that this was not as transmissible as measles is. The potential does exist for the emergence of a virus that has higher transmissibility. But you know, with respiratory pathogens, the risk for transmissibility is generally higher.
I see. You know, at the last year, at sort of the very beginning of the whole lockdown and everything, when everybody was turning to Netflix, the movie Contagion soared to the top of the Netflix charts. And sort of, you know, provided a Hollywood example of what a lot of scientists said was the real thing happening outside. It obviously has been bad. But do you believe human beings will ever fully win the war against viruses, either through vaccines or perhaps gene therapies or genetic engineering? Or are we always going to be one step behind in the battle? Are we always just playing catch up with a viral outbreak somewhere or the what's around the corner?
Just as a layperson, if I want to chime in, the war against viruses sounds as useful as the war against drugs. I don't think this will ever go anywhere, if you ask me, but I'm really not the expert here on this panel.
Yeah.
I think the best is to be well-armed with basic science and because then in the end, you know, whatever comes your way, you'll at least have the tools And as we've shown in this latest battle, if you've got the government engaged and you have technologies available, you can tackle it pretty rapidly.
Okay, so where there's political will, there is a way then.
I think I would add to what Jay said that, in fact, the rapidity with which we successfully responded to this pandemic is a really good example of how we can be prepared. The RNA vaccines are based upon years and years worth of work that actually go back to the original SARS pandemic. Its original emergence of SARS-1. And so people have been working on this technology for almost 20 years to try and advance the development of new vaccines. And I think we need to take that general approach of being prepared against all sorts of different types of pathogens because we don't know where the next human threat is coming from, or even animal threat because or plant threat, because we depend upon everything in the world around us in order to exist.
Turning to something a little bit different, as prominent and accomplished men in the hard sciences, was being a personal challenge at times in the scientific field for you? Did any of you experience discrimination in the profession that you had to deal with?
I don't know about discrimination. At least it wasn't outward discrimination. I would say that I was always a little cautious about revealing my sexual preference. And so maybe a lot of it was in my own mind. And having good role models was so important, someone I could look up to, model their behavior or not. But just having role models in the workplace, I think, was hugely important. And I have tried to be that myself for other people who are either coming into my lab or younger colleagues at work.
And I'd like to add that I, for instance, chose my career path specifically to minimize the risk of discrimination. And that was one of the reasons why I was so thrilled to learn about role models at Berkeley. I mean, when I had my when I made my first steps into my independent career, I chose Berkeley specifically because I knew that Jay was on the faculty and Harvey Blanch was on the faculty and Carolyn Bertozzi was on the faculty. And that, first of all, boosted my confidence that I could follow along this lines, and secondly, also really was an indicator that there is less discrimination to be feared. I did encounter discrimination at the student level, but I would say at the professional level, I have not been exposed to outright discrimination. Of course, there is such a thing as macho total synthesis and the people behind it. I felt less comfortable with.
So I would echo what's already been said. I feel that we're quite fortunate in academic science, in fact, that we tend to work with a bunch of quite enlightened people. And therefore, I haven't really had to deal with any personal discrimination. But I do think that earlier in my career, I was not so aware of obvious role models in science or people who were openly gay. And I think that sort of served as a barrier to me myself being open about my own sexual orientation. And so I've tried to keep that in mind as I've progressed throughout my career, because I think it benefits our trainees to realize that there is a place for them in our community. And there isn't a barrier that limits how far you can go in our community.
I just to add to that a bit. I was featured on a science program on television, and this has been a few years ago. And there was a delay in getting it out because they were having a debate within the producers about whether they should out me on television. And they had traveled to our family farm in Nebraska and interviewed my father and even asked him about it. And then it finally came out on television, and I got emails, and I could watch the emails come in from the East Coast to the middle of the country, to the mountain states, to the Pacific states, because the emails were coming in from people telling me how thankful they were that I had come out on a scientific program on television. These were largely scientists who were telling stories about how they were discriminated against in the workplace. And so it was saddening to see that it is happening, but it was also thrilling to see that just something simple like that could make a difference in people's lives. And that really it further convinced me of the importance of having good role models.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What words or advice would you have for young LGBT plus students who are thinking about pursuing careers in science? Any advice? Any words of encouragement or caution? That you might
just do it. It's one of the best professions you can choose, right? Especially as an LGBT plus person.
Okay.
And I'd say work hard, but I'd say that to everybody who goes into science. Because it does take a lot of really hard work. I mean, most of us got to where we are by working extremely hard and loving what we do. And I guess I would say that that has to be the biggest part of it, is that you really have to love it, because science is difficult and challenging and super fun. And it's my hobby as well as being my work.
And it can be occasionally incredibly frustrating, right? So you have to be very frustration tolerant in science and deal with delayed gratification, et cetera.
I think I would agree that pursuing your passion is what you need to do. And don't give up on your idea just because you haven't yet convinced others of its validity. In science, the one thing that we get very accustomed to is rejection. I think we're professionals in handling rejection, whether it's manuscripts, grants, job offers that we make to people. I think we have to learn how to deal with that and accept it and embrace it as part of our lives.
But you also have to be really in love with the minutiae of science, right? This is sort of with the little experimental details. If the really true grand discoveries are very rare, right? And far and in between, the so-called Sternstunden, as one says in German, the star hours, right? They happen, but they really don't come along every other month. You also should have joy in running a gel, right? And crystallizing a compound. And that's what I had as a graduate student always. And I lament that as a professor, I get less and less of this. I'm just pushing papers. I'm not making bonds anymore. In reality, I'm just making bonds on a computer and on a piece of paper. you have to have this ability to enjoy the daily routines as well, right? In addition to pursuing grand hypotheses and dreams.
But you're the architect now.
You have to also deal with setbacks.
Science. If I could end on one sort of maybe a sensitive question, as more and more research tends to show that one's sexual orientation may be genetically influenced or the basis for it to some extent, how do you feel as you know, researchers and scientists about the pursuit by some scientists of finding out whether or not you could, what, edit away or change one's sexual orientation through gene editing and splicing? Is this one of those areas of research that we should oppose? Or should we fear or should we embrace? What if, you know, it's been certainly written about in literary plays and things, you know, what if you can change one's personality, one's orientation because of editing their genes? Should we allow that? Do it? Jay?
Look, it's not limited to sexual orientation, right? I mean, in theory, one can, and they've already, Chinese scientists have already shown this, that you can edit the human genome. And, you know, I think, strictly speaking, we should be against it in any form, except maybe for diseases.
I think it's also very, very challenging to think about how one could actually edit the right constellation of genes, because behavioral traits have to be incredibly complicated. And to what extent they're influenced by developmental effects, I think, is also unclear. So I doubt very much, certainly not in my lifetime, that there will ever be the prospect or possibility, nor would I ever want there to be the prospect of or possibility. I actually enjoy being a gay man. And I doubt that you could actually engineer that trait in people, even if it were ethically okay. But I think one of the benefits of CRISPR is, in fact, the possibility of actually correcting diseases. There are several that are just single genetic changes. A good example is cystic fibrosis. And if we could actually really transform the lives of people who have that genetic change in their genome, it would be phenomenal.
I'm also optimistic. I don't think you can pray the gay away and you can't CRISPR it out.
Okay. I've done some reading on CRISPR, but you know, as you say, it's kind of a moral decision as a community, as humanity, but there are certainly potentially governments in the world who are anti-gay and may see this as something they would actually put research dollars towards. How do we deal with that as individuals and scientists around the world of opposing that?
Well,
is that a rhetorical question?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's something that state departments need to deal with when it comes to governments, other governments encouraging it or funding it. You know, it's, as was already said, it's going to be a complicated thing to do. We probably won't see it in our lifetimes, but we do have to be aware of it. And I think we do have to educate the public. It comes back to public education and making sure everybody realizes the importance of it, why it can be used for good and how it can be used for evil, and that people should be against that.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, listen, on that note, we're just about at time. I want to really thank all three of you for just a incredible discussion. Thank you for giving us your time, as well as your thoughts and insights. And I'll turn it back over to Sean.
Thank you, Peter. So we're getting ready for our next panel, but I do have two questions that came in, and these are for our panelists for the first panel. You mentioned the importance of role models. Who were your role models?
I named mine already. And then there's Alexander von Humboldt, who I'm convinced was gay.
Jay, Sean?
Yeah, I'll say for me, it was Harvey Blanche when I came to Berkeley as a professor. He was my senior colleague there. And to this day is a role model.
I think I've had lots of role models, and I think people serve as role models at different stages of your career. And it hasn't always been gay people that have been my role models. I think we can all think back to a time in science where the advancement of women in science was also quite challenged. In fact, it's still a hot topic that is a problem if you look at the ranks of faculty amongst academic institutions and how many women are advanced to the leadership positions. And so I've had a variety of role models throughout my career, including my former advisor, Gail Wirtz, who was a professor at the University of Alabama in Birmingham, where I was a postdoc. And then during my time at Harvard Medical School, I would say that Steve Harrison was among my role models. There are many others that have been role models for me during my career.
And actually, along these lines, I mean, a role model doesn't have to be somebody super accomplished, right? The person who turned me from a biologist to a synthetic organic chemist was Ada Götzinger, a little-known female chemist at the University of Vienna, who was 30 years ahead of her time, right? If she were operating in the 2000s, she would be a superstar. In 1970, she was lured back to Vienna from the NIH, actually. She was working with Bernard Wittkopf at the NIH and was lured back to Vienna with promises of academic career. And then she was just sidelined and ridiculed as a science Amazon, as they called her, right? In her frustration, or in she poured her love into conveying her love for science to students, and she was enormously influential. I mean, I really owe this woman, Ada Götzinger, my career. I would not have been a chemist, a successful chemist for that matter.
Awesome. And the next question I have that came in, what organizations do you belong to as scientists that are affiliated with the LGBTQ+ community? And those can be just any organizations that you feel are connected or have helped you as a member of the community.
I'll name one, and I don't know that I have the proper name, but there's an organization for LGBTQ scientists and engineers. And if I were in my Berkeley office, I have an award that I could just go read off. Certainly that organization, Noble Stop, that's what it is, is an organization I belong to and have attended meetings.
Yeah, I would add to Noggle Stop also 500 Queer Scientists, which has a lot more than 500. that's an organization that I am part of too.
Awesome. Well, thank you. Thank you, Peter, Sean, Dirk, and Jay for sharing your experience with us today. Thank you for being part of today's program. And at this time, I will ask you if you're ready to go ahead and close down your cameras and turn off your microphones as we get ready to bring on our next panel for creating opportunities. If I can ask our next panel to make sure their cameras and microphones are on so we can begin our discussion on building networks and securing funding. At this time, I'd like to introduce you to Gabrielle Legend, CEO of Visioneer IT. And Gabrielle, I'll let you introduce the panel.
All right, thank you so much, Sean. I appreciate that. We have with us today some amazing, amazing panelists today. And I don't think I can do them justice by introducing them. So I want you all each to introduce yourselves. And I'm going to start with Amita.
Hi, good afternoon or good morning and whatever time zones everybody's in. Hi, I'm Amita Mehta, and I have had an amazing career run in financial services for 25 years, and 3 years ago decided to launch my own consulting practice, AMP, Amita Made It Possible. And it's just been an interesting run. You know, just a little backdrop about myself, my family, we were refugees from Uganda when I was just a child back in the, or baby when we were in the 70s. You know, all my life experiences as an Indian, a woman, and then later in life as a lesbian has informed all of my work, professionally and personally. And as far as it goes in terms of what I'm doing recently, in terms of AMP consulting, I'm helping organizations really figure out and develop and sustain their diversity and inclusion practices. And then also as a career architect, I help individuals really realize their potential in terms of what they want to do in terms of their careers, in terms of transition or just being better authentic leaders. So that's my intro. So thank you. I'm so happy to be here.
Thank you again for that. That's you have an amazing background and I love your energy. So next I want to move on to Sabrina. Sabrina, tell us more about you.
Hi, Gabriel. Thank you so much. So glad to be here with all of you. My name is Sabrina Kent. I use she, her pronouns. I'm the Senior Vice President overseeing supplier diversity and programs at the National LGBT Chamber of Commerce. And really excited to have this discussion today with some amazing people who are near and dear to my heart. So for work at the National LGBT Chamber of Commerce, we help businesses that are majority owned, operated, and controlled by an LGBT person or persons gain access to contracting opportunities. We work with over 330 corporate partners, most of whom are Fortune 500 and 1,000 ranked firms who look to us to accept our certification to gain access to working with our diverse LGBT-owned businesses and their supply chains. And then we also work on the state and municipal level to pass legislation that is inclusive of LGBT businesses in contracting opportunities, as well as with federal government agencies and hopefully soon a blanket-wide opportunity in the federal government for LGBT businesses. So very proud to be a part of today's discussion on a personal level. I am half Indian. My mom's an immigrant from Punjab, India. I was born in Canada, grew up in the United States. I also come from a family of business owners. My mom was a woman business owner. She still actually is. I don't know why I said was. My dad was a business owner. My brother is a business owner. So it's just pretty amazing that my entire family is a family of entrepreneurs, and I get to support entrepreneurs in my work and entrepreneurs in my community, the LGBTQ community. So I'm very excited to have this conversation. And Gabriel, thanks for being our fearless leader today.
No problem. Sabrina, just like you, everyone in my family is a business owner. I actually didn't know that about you. We've been colleagues and friends for the last few years. So I'm glad I learned that about you. That is awesome. I think some of my family members are actually listening. So hello, if you guys are out there. So thank you again for that. So Safi, I want to jump to you next because I know you have an amazing background as well. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure. Yes. So my name is Safi Mojiti. My pronouns are he, him. I am a Black trans man who was born in Nigeria, moved here when I was about 5 years old. I've been a cybersecurity practitioner for about 14 years now, and I really supported a range of organizations, both in the public and private sector during my career. I'm currently a senior technical program manager at Slack, where I align, unblock, and accelerate security programs within the organization to really keep Slack safe and secure for all its users and consumers. I am also the founder of an organization called Hacking the Workforce, which we'll talk about a little bit more a little later in the session. But prior to Slack, I served as a security subject matter expert for NASA for about 10 years, where I led, 8 years, where I led compliance and engineering teams. I did similar work supporting FDIC, Office of the Vice President, Department of Justice, just to name a few. And in my free time, I am currently wrapping up my doctorate in cybersecurity while I also try to teach some folks cybersecurity as an adjunct professor. So
Awesome. That is great. As you know, I have a background in cybersecurity, so I'm so excited again to have you on this panel because we definitely have a lot in common when it comes to that. So last but not least, Braxton, tell us more about yourself, about your business, Stealth Bros Co. We know you're doing some amazing stuff. Tell us, we want to know all the details.
Yes, absolutely. So my name is Braxton Fleming. I use he, him pronouns. I've actually been a licensed practical nurse for the past 11 years. I started Stealth Bros & Co. back in 2017, a year after I had first started lead medically transitioned from female to male. And that has been absolutely amazing. Stealth Bros & Co. is a luxury dive kit company that helps provide storage for on the go or for right at home. One of our other main things, our other main products is our Sharps containers. And our Sharps containers are very unique because we're offering style. We want to give back to the community that's less looked at. You know, you think of your injections, you think of, oh, I'm gonna just throw this in a regular bag. No, that's part of your everyday life. And that's what Stealth Bros & Co. is all about. We're trying to give back to the people to make them feel good and giving them a sense of individuality when they take that shot every week or every day. So that's what I'm all about here. And also I'm a fiance and I have two younger sons that are 9 and 11, and they are awesome. So I'm always on the go, always doing everything. But yes, and lastly, I also have entrepreneur parents as well. My mother is a beautician, and actually she was for 25 years and then started a whole trucking company with her husband. So that's what she does now. And then my father, he's a mechanical engineer, and he also had a completely separate side business doing that along with working for Bell Atlantic and other major companies. But yeah, so I had a crazy upbringing with entrepreneur parents, always a go-getter mentality. So yeah, that's about it for me.
Awesome. Thank you so much for sharing. Like you, I also have children. I've got 4 children and 4 grandchildren. So it's been an amazing experience, amazing experience. So with that, I want to jump into some questions because I know everybody's curious about our journey, how we each individually got here, what it's like. And so with that being said, I want to start off with Amita. So as I understand it, you launched AMP Consulting after 25 years in financial services industry, right? And so interesting enough, your firm helps people with career transitions. So can you talk to us a little bit about that pivotal moment within your career that helped springboard you into launching AMP Consulting? Can you take us on that journey?
Sure. And you know what? I need to add too, like I come from a family of entrepreneurs. My grandfather moved from India to set up and establish a steel manufacturing plant to help the British build the railroad. So so that just sort of clicked with me as you guys were all speaking. But I would say just sort of, it's just been like an evolution for me in terms of, you know, it wasn't one like pivotal moment. It was just sort of like this journey in terms of the more authentic I became and the more I leaned into my truth and lived out loud as a leader and recognizing as the more, you know, the more I started to move up into the ranks in financial services, it was interesting. There were less and less people like me in terms of female, Indian, lesbian. And the more I leaned into all of those qualities and all the skill sets and experience that I had built, I started to realize I was creating a brand for myself where people were feeling inspired and wanting to really think about how they were managing them, you know, themselves. Because I was a career corporate girl, you know, at age 10, I had a resume, I had my business cards, and you know, and so I think that it was just something that I was just, I was a career professional. But when I started coaching people in terms of living their authentic selves, in terms of being true leaders and betting on themselves, I realized I actually have a brand, and you know, I should start walking the talk. And so it was about like a year in the making when I realized it was really time for me to start thinking about my passion and what I wanted to focus on next, because you can sleepwalk through your life. You can sleepwalk through your career. My life was sort of exploding a little bit. You know, I was going through a divorce. Mom got sick. And then it just got me really thinking about like, okay, well, what do I want in my life? So I think there were just some like personal moments that occurred, but I was just well set up for the next step. And so it was just one of those experiences where I was living out loud. I was representing the organization. You know, so I used to work for JP Morgan, worked in their global diversity office as one of my roles, and then at Prudential, you know, really supporting a lot of senior leadership. And then it was just time to really think about like, okay, well, I think I have a brand. There's something here. And I think I can work with other brands and individuals. So that was like sort of like the tipping point for me. And so I was able to lean into like all my allies, senior leadership, and let them know that, look, I have tremendous runway. I really want to test out my wings and see what I can do out here in the world of service and helping people, whether it's allies, whether it's saving people's lives in terms of living an authentic life and helping people career transition. So that was really it. Like it was just something like, yeah, I could always go back to corporate, but let's test out the wings. And so it's like, yeah, I have my own brand. So decided to launch AMP, which is like my initials. So it all lined up. The universe worked itself out.
That is absolutely amazing that you were able to just make that pivot. There's so many people that spend a ton of time in a specific industry and never end up, you know, going out and deciding to live authentically. So congratulations to you on that. Thank you again for sharing. You know, and so in the spirit of continuing that dialogue around authenticity and even finance, right, where the industry where you come from, I think it's a good time to talk about the lack of funding opportunities in the LGBT community. And so with that, Sabrina, NGLCC has really been carrying the torch when it comes to the LGBT community in the area of equal access to capital. And I want to know if you can talk to us a little bit about the work that NGLCC has been doing to help close that gap and how that overarching goal will change funding sources for LGBT businesses.
Thanks, Gabriel. That's such an important question because LGBT business owners approach access to capital and funding in such different ways than I think people would generally recognize. So first and foremost is that all across this country and over half of our states, LGBT individuals can be denied access to credit and loans simply for being LGBT. And these issues are extremely exacerbated when we add in particularly gender and race and ethnicity into the equation, right? And then we look at ability as well. Just last week, actually, the House passed H.R. 1443, which would essentially extend benefits to LGBT businesses and equal access to credit as a part of existing civil rights law, which is amazing. This is awesome. The Equality Act would actually cover this, all these bases for us on a federal level and in so many other walks of life. But what we do at NGLCC is we first have tried to take a look at where our businesses are approaching access to capital. We find, and I think some of the business owners here can speak to this, we find a lot of times that we're looking at a self-funding model, right? Like Braxton, for example, is a nurse and he was putting everything from his own pocket into the development of his business, right? He was taking that investment out against himself. We see business owners putting their investments on credit cards because they can't get access to capital. They are going to friends and family members if they have those resources in their networks. They might be looking at VCs and angel investors. And so we're proud to work with organizations like Gangels and the Pride Fund VC that are specifically focused on investing in LGBT-owned businesses, which is pretty amazing. There are other organizations that look at investing from a diverse lens, like Backstage Capital as well. But then what we do at MGLCC as well is, particularly in this last year, is really focus in on the recovery for our businesses and the imminent issues that they've been facing due to COVID. So whether that's being a resource sharing partner of the SBA, talking about idle loans, PPP, and knowing there are a lot of issues around those things, but still trying to be a purveyor of information, right? We can't directly give out these loans, but we want to be able to connect our businesses with our bankers at financial institutions that we know are going to take care of them, not in spite of the fact that they're LGBT, but because of that, right? And so we really try to approach it from that lens, working with SBDCs through our corporate partners like TD and Wells Fargo, for example, just to name a few. And then also, we've been really privileged that we have been able to work with companies and organizations that want to invest back in our LGBT community. So earlier this year, we were able to give out grants to our Black-owned LGBT businesses that faced hardship during COVID-19. We've also been able to do the same broadly through a big partnership with UPS. By the end of this year, thanks to the support of other corporate partners like Grubhub, Google, Johnson & Johnson, Coca-Cola, UPS, as I mentioned, we're going to be able to give out nearly $1 million in loans to, or in, not in loans, in grants to support our LGBT businesses who are needing to recover from what the devastation last year had on them. So, you know, really we're looking at the issue of access to capital from two lenses. First, just access to being able to start and develop a business or grow an existing business. And in some cases now trying to keep our businesses operational or prevent them from operating in the red, right, due to the devastation of the last year. And then I'll close, you know, with the thought that as well, a couple weeks ago, we released a report with CNBC taking a look at the climate for the LGBT business community right now. And I'm really happy to say that 80% of LGBT small businesses feel that they're going to make a full recovery by 2022. That's excellent. But there is still considerable unease when we're talking about hiring, expansion, funding, access to capital, right? And so I'm happy to share the details on that, on those survey findings in the chat. But it's something, you know, I think that we forget a lot when we're looking at the LGBT business owner and diverse business owners at large, why it can be so much more difficult when you just bring identity into the equation to be a business owner. And we disproportionately are business owners for fear of being discriminated against in traditional employment chains. So I think it's really important to call that to light. I appreciate you asking the question.
Thank you so much for that. I am just so proud of the work that MGLCC is doing. I'm so proud to have found MGLCC a couple of years ago and have just dove headfirst into being involved. And, you know, I'm honored to be an integral part of the work MGLCC is doing by co-chairing the TGNC task force. So, again, thank you for really, but you called me a fearless leader. I call you definitely a fearless leader. So I'm trying to follow in your footsteps. Thank you again. Thank you, Justin as well. I know he does a ton of work. So we appreciate you. I think everybody here appreciates MGLCC and what they're doing in the community, especially as business owners. So with that being said, Braxton, you happen to be one of those MGLCC certified trans business owners. You are also one of the few who has a physical product, right? You have a physical product. So yes, launching physical products can be challenging, as I think we all know, due to manufacturing costs. I see. I love it. You know, manufacturing costs can really kill any business, right? And so I'm curious if you were able to access really any funding to help you with the manufacturing costs, or did you have to completely self-fund the whole entire effort on your own?
Absolutely. I, like Sabrina touched on earlier, I actually did self-fund Stealth Bros. I actually had just paid off my Capital One credit card right before I got into this mode of saying, I'm going to do this. And I said, you know what, I've wasted money before, so why not again? And this time I actually could have a return on investment. So I maxed it out. And shortly after that, a couple months later, I was able to make that return back and just continue moving the business forward. So I was very blessed in that aspect to just have that initial funding. And I think that it's really, you know, when starting a business, it's really all about, it's really a process. Everything in life is a process. You'll hear me say that a lot, because it's not like you just have to buy this, buy that, buy this all at one time. You know, this week I did this, the next week I got that, the next week I got that. So it's all about, you know, taking those proper steps in order to move forward. And, you know, it's not, I don't want to say it's not hard to fund yourself, because obviously I had a whole career behind me. But if you just put your mind to it, even if you work two jobs, you can do it. You just have to take the appropriate steps and move at your own pace.
That's excellent. I agree with you. There's so many of us who end up needing to bootstrap our businesses due to lack of access to capital or credit. And for many years, I bootstrapped Visioneer IT because I didn't qualify for loans. So I definitely feel you, you know, when people talk about, you know, going to work during the day and then coming home and, you know, working on your own private business, you know, to get it off the ground. I think a lot of us tend to start there. So thank you again.
Thank you.
So Safi, as I understand it, you have launched your own nonprofit called Hacking the Workforce. The work you are doing is near and dear to my heart, right? I've been a cybersecurity professional for a number of years, and I would love it if you could speak to why hacking the workforce is different than other programs, and why technology and cybersecurity more specifically is such a great career path for Black LGBTQ individuals.
Absolutely. So I guess I'll kind of start from my own experience being a member of an intersectional or member of intersectional identities at, you know, in the cybersecurity field. So I think, you know, being in the field for a while, I've always just been shocked and stunned and certainly saddened by, you know, the lack of true diversity and representation for other Black LGBTQ people in this space. You know, if you think about the US population in the United States, Black people make up about 16-17% of the population in the United States, yet only make up 3% of the tech industry, right? So if we're thinking about products and services that are being developed for the masses, right? Entire countries and, you know, sometimes globally used, you know, those solutions are only really being addressed with one homogeneous mindset or group in the room, right? And, you know, studies have shown homogeneous groups sometimes tend to arrive at decisions more quickly than they would have had there been some diversification of thought in the room with them, right? So they're more likely to, you know, engage in groupthink and not really challenge each other on what could potentially be wrong with this solution, right? How can we potentially make this product a lot better? And you see a lot of that right now with artificial intelligence, for example, right? You know, we're seeing artificial intelligence being used in surveillance in public streets, being used to identify potential criminals. And if there was not a Black person in the room to test how well that product works on someone who has melanin, how can we accurately say, hey, we're going to use these systems and tools to protect society, right? It's not inclusive, and it does a huge disservice to not only, you know, the companies that are putting out this software and these products, but entire demographics of people who have been left behind because of the lack of diversity in tech and specifically cybersecurity. So, you know, as I started to think about a lot of those things and doing a lot of the research for my doctorate, I started to notice there is a huge gap here. I have mentored people for the past few years, and it's been super, super, super fulfilling and gratifying. You know, really helping people enter a different way of thinking and potentially a different way of life than they were used to, particularly in the tech field and cybersecurity. You know, people are a lot more comfortable with who they are in the world because they have been able to be provided with a mechanism to help advocate for themselves in the workplace. You know, I see a lot of the social inequalities and systemic oppression that marginalized people confront every day. And that certainly is amplified in the digital industry. But, you know, I want people to know, this is the thing I always communicate to people. Right now, to date, there are more than 500,000 open cybersecurity positions in the United States, right? And if we're talking about globally, that number goes up upwards of 3.5 million needed cybersecurity professionals. So, you know, I kind of said, you know, the demand is great and the need for our community is even greater. I have to figure out a way to marry these two things. And so as a result, I founded Hacking the Workforce. So Hacking the Workforce is, as you mentioned, a nonprofit organization, and we're really dedicated to accelerating social and professional development. And within that, inclusive and sustainable economic growth for Black queer people. For our community, this means full employment, decent work, and that it's free from discrimination as a result from being an underrepresented minority in that field. You know, our mission really is to create a safer world where Black LGBTQ people have access to opportunities and representation in cybersecurity. And a little bit further than, you know, just getting people, it's not just getting people jobs, right? It's not just decreasing the gap or the workplace gap, workforce gap in cybersecurity. It's more, I want people to feel empowered to make moves and changes in their life that essentially help them create a financially self-sustaining opportunity for themselves and their family to truly begin to combat systemic racism and obtain generational wealth. You know, I think what sets my program apart, you know, we offer more than just, you know, the traditional mentoring and advisory. So we do that. But in addition to that, we also focus on, you know, healing, nurturing, supporting the whole individual as they enter this potentially, you know, very lucrative and, you know, this career that can really change their lives in some ways. But I think I struggled with some of the other organizations currently available because a lot of them I felt like weren't really addressing our community's needs, right? And it's really the intersection of our identities that make us different. And it's a benefit to potential employers, but I don't think folks are necessarily seeing that, the greatness yet, right? You know, we're living at a time when even pre-pandemic, you know, the LGBTQ population faced, you know, unique financial challenges, as you mentioned, Sabrina. And, you know, I want our programming to really speak to the whole person. So we not only do we provide career advising, but we also have partnered with other Black queer-owned organizations that really demonstrate the value and importance of centering the Black queer experience while navigating spaces that have traditionally not been created for us, right? And they haven't really been created for inclusivity. And so we'll be providing preventative mental health services, you know, helping folks work through how to take care of themselves and future generations from an economic standpoint. And as I mentioned, you know, making sure that particularly in this post-pandemic era where, you know, remote employment has really made maintaining a separation between home and work almost impossible, right? So I want to make sure that folks understand that we are more than just the person that you see at work every day, right? We are the sum of all of our experiences. And, you know, you can't separate that when you create programming for people. If you do, I just feel like you're really doing a disservice to your population that you're trying to serve.
Wow. I remember many years ago when I got into cybersecurity, there was not many people of color, right? I was the only person of color. And at the time I was still female. And so being a Black female in a predominantly male-dominated field was just very intimidating. And so that's what makes me so excited to really see the evolution of hacking the workforce. Because I believe there's great opportunity for our community to really get involved in such a high demand field. So kudos to you. Thank you so much for jumping out there and creating such a powerful organization. So Amita, you have a very interesting background as well, right? You mentioned that your family is originally from Uganda. You came out later in life. And so I'm curious if your layered identities and your career in finance created a resilience in you that really shortened that runway to the success you're experiencing today.
Yeah, you know, I've been thinking about that a lot in terms of, I think there's been like sort of like my definition of success has evolved over time. Cause I'd always like do these like every 10 years, like, am I where I need to be? Am I right where I need to be? And I would say, you know, having all those intersectional points, like to your point, Safi, right? You know, being, you know, lesbian, Indian, refugee. But I would say just even my life experiences, because I hid a lot of who I was along the way in terms of we got out of Uganda with our lives. So we lived with the Amish, got integrated there, and we had no money. So we were living on the welfare system. And at the same time, trying to get a good grasp of just being integrated into being an American kid. And so I just wanted to be American. That's all I wanted. I just wanted to be American. I didn't want to be different. I didn't want to look different. And so there was always like this, like always like an obstacle, you know, so to speak, Gabrielle. So it's one thing. It's like, oh, I'm recognizing that we're poor. Okay. I'm recognizing that we are Hindu. We don't go, you know, we go to church because that's, you know, we got integrated into, you know, it was the church services that sponsored us to come to America to be contributing members of society. So it's been like an evolution. So I think it just the relatability to people, like in my sort of emotional EQ, I think that's like sort of the secret to like the success in terms of having the confidence of being bold to put myself out there. Because yeah, like you're gonna live through life, you're gonna have to be resilient. But why not take a chance? Why not bet on yourself? So I think for me, the definition has evolved because it was always about, okay, well, I'm going to use sports, you know? So no one knew that like there's this, you know, this little Indian girl. I grew up with three brothers, so they always needed an extra person on their team. So I learned to play sports, you know, and became a basketball player. And basketball, academics, those were my true metrics of success. And so that I knew that that was going to be my ticket out. And so then that's what like led to, you know, colleges, job offers at premier brands and things like that. So I think, you know, it's just sort of like the measure of success. Like, I think I still have 20 to 30 more years, I hope, you know, in terms of what this runway is going to look like. Cause like, as you mentioned, Gabrielle, yes, I came out in my 30s because that's when I was fully self-actualized in terms of, look, you know, like Sabrina, you can attest, you know, I'm sure you can relate to this, right? My parents, you're going to marry an Indian boy. And so I'm like, and then I had my bio data ready, you know? And so.
And a doctor and a lawyer and a business executive. Yeah.
Yeah. And, but my dad was proud. Look, he used to be an executive at Barclays Bank. And so he was like, you know, just over the moon that I'm, you know, at you know, working on Wall Street. So, but when it finally came, I think the reckoning for me, was when I started to become more self-actualized in terms of like, what's going to make me happy in terms of not like trying to be that dutiful daughter, not trying to be somebody that, that society wants me to be. And so finally I, you know, really decided to lean into myself. And yeah, I was unproductive at work. People thought I was aloof. People didn't trust me anymore. I wasn't creating a climate of trust. And so when I finally decided to like call my biggest ally, my twin brother, to just talk to him about this, it was like, oh gosh, I'm going to lose everything. I'm going to lose my family. I'm going to lose my career, everything I worked so hard for. I'm going to lose my parents, my religion. And so I think just being able to take that first step to come out to somebody that I trust and sort of test the waters, so to speak, I think that's when I realized, wow, there's so much power in who you can be in life. And so I think that that's just where my brother embraced me. He's like, you're still my sister. You're still incredible in your career. And yeah, you'll always be my wonder twin. And so, you know, it's, I don't know. I think just being able to lean into your allies is really, that sort of like accelerated my success, really, is being true to myself, being authentic, leaning into everything that I am as a person and as a human, and using my, you know, I would say my super, you know, superhuman quality, or like my, you know, superpower is, you know, EQ, because I can relate to a lot of people because of all the intersections that I have. So yeah, has it accelerated it? Yeah, you know, I think it's a great question. I think it's just something that's just made me whole. And who knows, there's still more like on this runway of life. So yeah, but it's been such an evolution. Success is how we define it. And I'm loving the new generation that's coming along the way, the Gen Z, the alpha generation, like, you know, they are leaning into themselves. So like coming out to them, they're just like, I feel like there is progress being made, but still, you know, steps to take. But I really appreciated that question.
You're very welcome. I agree with you. You know, that Generation Alpha, is that what it is? Alpha? They're having a whole different experience than we had many years ago. So I'm so glad to see the progress that's being made, and that they can live authentically sooner than we did.
Look, and I have a 14-year-old now. Like now I have a 14-year-old. Like I never thought I would have kids, but with my partner, you know, I have a 14-year-old and a 10-year-old in my life, and they just love me as a lesbian, the dad lesbian, you know. So it's just like, wow, this is totally normal. You know? So yeah, it's just such an interesting generation that we're living in.
It is indeed. So I want to shift the conversation a little bit and talk about community. I think we all can agree that networking and connections are what help sustain businesses. And so, Sabrina, can you tell us a little bit about the different resources and benefits that NGLCC affords LGBT BEs, business owners, as a result of their certification?
Thanks, Gabriel. Yeah. Well, we've got two examples here of some amazing LGBT business owners that have taken advantage of all that certification has to offer. I mean, I would say first and foremost, right, we're talking about networking to gain contracting opportunities, right? So whether that's us directly being able to recommend LGBT businesses for potential RFPs, that's a request for proposals for those who might be unfamiliar, whether it's recommending our LGBT businesses, helping to forge those connections with corporations or government partners, that's what we're here to do. But we're also here to educate, help our businesses grow, scale, connect them with opportunities like the access to capital opportunities I was just talking about before, or different grant opportunities or exposure opportunities. It's also, certification is what you make of it, right? It's a matter of, okay, if you want to sit in a database, which is what happens when you get certified, right? You get added to a database of fellow LGBT-owned businesses, over 1,700 in our database alone. And there are chambers that represent women, persons of color, folks with disabilities, veterans, which, by the way, as LGBT people, we belong to all of those groups as well. But in our database in particular, there's 1,700 LGBT-owned businesses, and then there are thousands more in other databases. And so I've heard businesses say, well, I'm sitting in the database. If they want to do business with me, they can find my company. Like, that's not how that works. You have to take advantage of the opportunity. You have to show up to programs. That is how Amita has been successful with her certification. That's how Braxton has been successful with his certification. They have shown up and taken advantage of opportunities, and both of them have been certified for a year or so, like not that long. And Braxton, I think, is a really good example of a business owner that's not only been able to take advantage of our educational opportunities, like our executive level training program, Accelerate. He's also been a part of a bunch of programs that our corporate partners offer as it relates to mentorship and their own educational programs. He's gotten contracting relationships out of it. He's got exposure opportunities. He's going to a corporate partner panel right after this. And he's also been able to network with other LGBT business owners. He's pitched in our Sip and Pitch Fridays. Amita's done the same thing. She was featured on our Asian American Heritage Month program and getting exposure for her company. Braxton was able to meet an attorney that helped him, I think it was get a trademark for South Bros, and has been able to advise him on a bunch of other issues. And that's just by taking advantage of being a part of the network, right? So if we're looking at in such a limited scope as to say that my certification is going to work for me, it only works for you if you make it work for you. And that means that you show up and you take advantage of opportunities and you use it as an opportunity to expand the footprint of your business and get your business out there. So there's that side. And then the other side is that we also educate our corporate partners and LGBT businesses on how to be inclusive to the LGBT community, right? There's a threshold, first of all, for what we will work with in terms of a corporate partner. We're not gonna put our businesses in a position where they're gonna work with a company that's going to potentially cut a contract with them later on for being LGBT. So there has to be a minimum threshold of having at least a 75 on the Human Rights Campaign Corporate Equality Index in order to partner with us. I'm proud to say that the last time I checked, we didn't work with any companies that were below an 82 on the Corporate Equality Index. But in addition to that, we also educate these companies. So last year, our Trans and Gender Nonconforming Task Force, we were able to host a training for corporate supplier diversity professionals to help them understand how to be ready to do business with trans entrepreneurs and their supply chains. We're also able to educate our fellow LGBT businesses, right? Not just on issues related to our community, but also on the intersectional issues that we experience as LGBT people, right? You get to hear from such a diverse array of LGBT business owners right here. And we need to dispel the myth that LGBT business owners are just cisgender white gay men, because we are so much more than that. We're women, we're persons of color. I said it before, veterans, folks with disabilities. And so what really we're really focused on too is ensuring that our LGBT businesses are working with each other to build opportunity or to create opportunity and to team up for opportunities and more.
Wow, wow, wow. That was a mouthful. It was just amazing. That's all I can say. NGLCC continues to do, again, amazing, amazing things. And I'm so excited to be part of such an amazing organization. So, since this is a USPTO event, we can't have a conversation and not talk about trademarks, right? And the importance of securing your brand. And as I understand it, Braxton, you went through the process of trademarking Stealth Bros & Co. And I'd love to know more about your experience and why it was important to you.
Absolutely. Okay, so my experience was very lengthy and it was a learning experience. Back in April of 2018, that was almost 5 months after launching my business, I knew I had to be trademarked. How did I know? Don't ask me. I think it's just the life of entrepreneur parents. I just knew that was something that I had to do to protect my brand, because I just knew that the way that it was moving, I wanted to stay secure. So applying for a trademark was really important for me. So when I filed, I actually went to the USPTO.gov website and I studied every single video for hours and days, thinking I could make myself into a trademarking lawyer. But that wasn't the case. So fast forward 2 years later, I actually joined NGLCC, and that's how Sabrina was speaking about earlier, how I was actually connected with one of the NGLCC trademark attorneys, which literally changed everything for me. And once I was able to get him onto my team, it was 5 months later that I was actually able to be issued my trademark. So it was almost a process of 2.5 years to get my trademark through. But with that connection through NGLCC, I don't think I would have made it happen, because all the other trademark lawyers that I spoke to outside the network, I don't know if it was because of who I am as a person, what my business stands for, but they weren't moving me in the direction that I needed to be moved. So that's when I said, Sabrina, I need help. And as always, she came through with a list of attorneys. So I got to choose whoever I wanted. And then I just chose the first one that stuck out to me. And he really helped move my business forward. And he helped me with a ton of other contracts and NDAs and everything else. So it's been actually an amazing experience. And I'm just super thankful that now that I am officially trademarked, it's a huge accomplishment for Stealth Bros & Co.
Braxton, like you, we recently here at Visionaire IT got our trademark completed. We worked with an amazing attorney. Her name is Raven Willis with New Millennial Legal. She was fast, she was knowledgeable, very responsive, and we had a great experience, very similar to how you said that you had a great experience with your attorney as well. So the next question is for Safi, and I really want to talk about TransTech. I know that you are heavily involved with TransTech, and can you, given your work with them and your own personal experience, can you speak to what allies can do better to help businesses like TransTech to empower more trans and gender non-conforming individuals?
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, that is a great question. I think, you know, as we talk about the lack of diversity in the business world, and, you know, certainly tech, I think organizations and businesses need to come to the realization that no matter how big or how small you are, you have to shift to being a way more diverse and inclusive organization if you aren't already. And I think that it's not just about the people part, right? Like, I think that certainly, you know, first and foremost, workplaces and environments should be inclusive and help people, you know, feel like they're coming to work and, you know, putting in a lot of time at an organization and feel like they are seen. And I think from the business sense, you know, it's not an option to no longer be inclusive, right? I think the ability for a business to, you know, be dynamic enough to see a need, you know, within their organization in terms of how they're treating their employees and being able to put in the plans to, you know, first of all, assess it, identify it, assess it, and then dedicate the necessary resources to fixing that. It has a direct correlation with your bottom line these days, right? As we work with organizations, while I'm with TransTech, you know, when I've been with TransTech, you know, we have wanted to make sure we communicate to folks that reach out to us, you know, really treat the lack of diversity in your organization the same way you would a risk, right? Risks are typically addressed with some level of executive buy-in, you know, to figure out what the solution is going to be. Then we dedicate the requisite financial support and resources so that we can mitigate that risk. You know, and I tell people or businesses, if you think about it that way, it's a lot easier to wrap your mind around what it's going to take to fix the problem. You know, businesses should really make sure they're promoting and demonstrating a culture that is not just tolerant of trans and gender non-conforming individuals, right? So TransTech is a great organization for businesses to really get behind, because we really prioritize mentoring and providing programming that raises the awareness of well-qualified members of the LGBTQ community for jobs that they may have in their organizations. It's really, you know, an incubator that focuses on economically empowering people. And we do that with, you know, practical, you know, career-ready skills. So, you know, upskilling folks, providing them to access to training platforms, LinkedIn Learning, Linux Foundations, for example. So, and as a board member, and yeah, I'm currently serving as the Director of Strategic Partnerships, I know that there's a lot of work to be done. And, you know, there have been organizations who have reached out to us to, you know, kind of help them assess those gaps, you know, come up with meaningful solutions to address them. And, you know, those organizations are looking for candidates who are diverse, right? But to Sabina's point, I think it's important that those employers meet our needs in terms of being in, you know, an LGBTQ or Black person. You know, you have to meet our standards for employment also, right? Like, just like we have organizations have job requirements, you know, as a community, we need to have those standards for ourselves when we can. And, you know, if an organization is really only addressing, you know, any type of diversity, whether it be, you know, Juneteenth or Pride or any of the other holidays, if you will, where folks can demonstrate their support via changing their, you know, social media icons and things like that, you know, that's no longer good enough. I think our community is starting to see through that. And, you know, some of it certainly looks performative. And that doesn't necessarily instill a level of trust that as an employer, I know that you see me in all of me, right? And again, you know, without doing that, you're really not serving a population, right? We, as traditionally, you know, we will face Black LGBTQ people will face a lot of systemic issues related to societal, economic, and, you know, certainly employment and advancement. But, you know, as I mentioned, TransTech is, you know, we're trying to do our part to really make sure our community has the right tools, or what we believe are the right tools for long-term success. And lastly, I always tell people or organizations, you can teach technical acumen, right? You can teach someone how to, you know, code. You can send someone to coding bootcamp and they're ready to perform their job, right? But what you can't teach are life lessons that come from lived experiences and working through and learning how to overcome those struggles. Those things, those are what truly expedites both professional and professional growth, right? Those are areas that you cannot instill inherent struggles that people have had to overcome with anyone else, right? Like, those are things that by being a member of an intersectional population or an underrepresented minority, those are things that we deal with on a day-to-day basis. So, you know, potentially dealing with a schedule slipping at work is something that kind of pales in comparison to what we deal with on a day-to-day basis ever since, you know, since we've been born.
That's amazing. TransTech is really leading the way in an area that's just kind of been pushed under the rug. You know, it's tough for many trans individuals to find employment, sustainable employment. And so I've always been a fan of Angelica Ross and TransTech Social, and I'm so proud of what you all are doing. So Sabrina, there's so much talk around diversity, inclusion, and allyship, and given NGLCC's relationships with corporations and corporate partners of varying sizes, can you tell us more about the real work of allyship, and which leads to transition in corporate culture and invites diverse voices and talent?
Yeah, that's a great question. Something that I just heard a week or two ago, which I thought was really great, was you're not an ally of a particular community until somebody from that community tells you you're an ally. Otherwise, you're an aspiring ally, which I thought was really awesome. I really like that. And even then, even if you are deemed an ally, there's always still work to be done, right? I think companies, first of all, you know, we talked a little bit about the power of Gen Z earlier. what was, I think, in the last 10 or so years, an option in terms of DEI, diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging, is now an imperative, right? Because Gen Z is saying, yeah, your checks don't mean as much to me as what your commitment to inclusion is. And that's not just from a policy level, that's not just from what we say we do, it's not just verbalized, right? It's in action. How are you actually working to affect communities positively, both within the workforce and externally? And so I think, and not I think, I know, there's the business imperative, right? There's the bottom line argument for how this particularly affects the revenue of a company or an organization. Speaking specifically from the LGBT lens, if an LGBT individual cannot bring their full selves to work, and that doesn't mean, you know, oh, there's no policies on the books to include LGBT people or protect them from non-discrimination. This is, do I feel comfortable enough to have a picture of my same-sex partner on my desk or to talk about my trans child around the water cooler? Having these typical interactions that sometimes folks that aren't a part of the community sort of take for granted. You know, am I going to be living in fear that I might not get that promotion, or that my boss is going to treat me differently, or that my colleagues are going to talk about me behind my back and misgender me? This significantly affects an LGBT person's productivity at work. We know that 30% of an LGBT person's productivity goes out the window when they have to live in fear, right? And so from an ethical perspective, I hate that. And from a business perspective, I hate it even more, because that means if you're paying somebody $100,000 a year to do a particular job, $30,000 is going out the window. And they're also not going to stick around. They're not going to stick around in places they don't feel safe. They're not going to stick around in places they don't feel accepted. So then it's a retention issue as well. That means that we have to bring in somebody new. We have to train them. We have to hire them. And hopefully they want to stick around, but who really knows? So I think first and foremost, companies have not just, they shouldn't just do this. They need to be practicing inclusion. They need to be bringing in experts from the community to train companies. Do not put it on the LGBT individual or the diverse person in that company to educate you on why you should be using the right pronouns or why you should be talking about race from a critical lens, from an intersectional lens. What that is not on the diverse individual, right? And so the first thing I can say is hire the experts that do this. We have LGBT businesses that do this. We have minority businesses that do this. Amita's company does this, right? We have trans-owned businesses that come in and talk about how to roll out fully trans-inclusive policies. Educate your company, provide metrics on where your teams go after they get trained on these things. They continue to keep this education ongoing, and then they start actually giving back to the communities that they're educating about, right? And making sure that their workplaces are inclusive. So one, education is so important, but then what's the follow-up to that? How do we live that in practice in this community? What are we doing to eliminate barriers for LGBT people, persons of color, folks with disabilities in our workforce, right? So it's awesome if you have LGBT people on your payroll. Are they sitting in your boardroom? Are they sitting in your C-suite offices? Those are the kinds of things that I want to know. Are there particular mentorship opportunities in place to support LGBT talent, right? And so I think just from not only from an internal standpoint of the talent that you attract and keep, this is also a marketplace imperative now too, because we are voting with our wallets. We are deciding that we're not going to go support Chick-fil-A. And I have no problem saying that right now. You will not catch me with some waffle fries in my hands. No matter how good they look, it's not going to happen, because this company is actively working against LGBT, but particularly trans and gender nonconforming people all across this country, right? And so companies have an imperative, and in order to stay relevant, right, usually the Fortune 5 circle out every, I think that it's 5 to 6 years. The companies that are going to stay for longer than that average term are going to be the companies that are actually in the forefront of inclusion, that are actually promoting allyship and creating active allies in their companies and creating cultures and environments that make people want to stick around and also make people want to buy from them. So off the high horse now.
Yeah, but I got to jump in there, Sabrina. I think you hit every nail on the head. I think also, like, who are organizations doing business with, right? Because I remember that was a tough call when I was in global diversity at JP Morgan Chase supporting the Pride group, and we had to like let go of Chick-fil-A. But people were like, but we love Chick-fil-A. But yes, we understand. And it's like, yeah, that makes sense. You know, so yeah. You know, it's a holistic approach, right? Who are you doing business with? What kind of vendors are you dealing, you know, working with? And does it line up to your value system? And look, employees now, talent, they're hip to all that. They look at that holistically. So I had to jump on that too.
I'm so glad you said that, because when we look at the LGBT business case for inclusion, and then I'm going to be quiet because I know we got to jump. We're looking at marketing to the LGBT community, pro-workplace inclusive policies, and then buying and investing back. And that's not just LGBT community, but diverse communities broadly. So thank you for that, Amita.
Thank you, Sabrina, for that, and Amita for jumping in. These are all just amazing paths to success for corporations who want to really, or people, individuals who really want to be good allies. And so, and not just t-shirt wearers, right? Right. They're like in it to win it. So thank you so much for that. Again, thank you to all of the panelists, everyone for being here. Thank you, Sean, for allowing me to actually moderate this amazing group of individuals. So I'm going to pass it back to you, Sean. Thank you again.
Well, Gabriel, first of all, thank you for those amazing questions, and all panelists, thank you for all of that information. I can't even begin to tell you how informative it was, and your perspective on our community. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I know we don't have time for questions, but I am going to ask one of each of you, and it's just a simple one. Are all of you open to being a mentor to somebody who wants to reach out to you?
Yes.
Yes.
All right. Well, thank you again for your time, and I look forward to people contacting you to reach out to you. I can't tell you how wonderful this has been. Thank you again, and I look forward to talking with you all very soon and working with you in the future. Right now, if you want to stick around, you don't have to, but you can turn off your cameras and mute your phone. I'll be talking about resources that are available to anyone who comes to USPTO. And Braxton, you touched on a lot of those already, so I'll have to thank you for that. If we can go ahead and get the next slide. So as you know, USPTO is headquartered in Alexandria, Virginia. We have 4 regional offices around the country. Those are Detroit, Denver, Dallas, and Silicon Valley. If you have questions or if you want to reach out to these offices, you can. You can find their information on our website at www.uspto.gov, which is our next slide if you want to move to that. You can find information there that will help you learn about the patent process, filing for a patent or a trademark, and general information to support inventors who have questions or need support. Moving on to our next slide. Inventor and entrepreneur resources are available. This is our hub for information. If you're looking for information on how to get started with the process, or do you have something that is considered patentable or trademarked, you can get that information here. I encourage you to go to uspto.gov/inventors for more information to learn the basics on the patent process, the trademark process, and where you can find support. Moving on to our next slide, we'll have more information about the USPTO Assistance Centers. These centers are open to help answer your basic questions. Braxton touched on it earlier that he went onto the USPTO webpage. He found information about trademarks and how to apply, and thought he was going to become an attorney for trademarks after going through everything. But if you go to our website, you will find information about going through the process. They have great videos that are informative. But if you don't want to just watch videos, you can contact these assistance centers to get information. They are open from 8:30 a.m. to 8 o'clock p.m. and the information is here and available to you to reach out at any time. If I can get the next slide. Another resource that may be available in your area, and you can look on our website for more information, are the Patent and Trademark Resource Centers. These are usually located at major libraries or universities across the country. When you go to the PTRC, you'll get information on basic steps for the patent process or the trademark process. The librarians will work with you to help you understand the process, guide you to forms, and provide you with information and services that we offer at USPTO. You can also learn how to do the search function, which will help you determine if your patent may exist already, or if you want information about a certain patent that you may be relating to. You'll learn all of this at the PTRCs, and they are available. They are free services, and we encourage you to go there. But you can find the locations at uspto.gov/PTRC. Next slide, please. At USPTO, we do give information about free legal assistance programs. We have our patent pro bono program, which works nationwide to help people who are not financially equipped to handle the process, and they'll work with you to determine if you're eligible. You can find out if you're eligible for the pro bono program or the law school clinic program on our website as well. So uspto.gov/pro bono patents or uspto.gov/law school clinic. Applicants must pay for all USPTO fees, but if you are eligible for the program, they will work with you through the process to help you obtain your patent or intellectual property. Next slide, please. Finally, we have our next program coming up. Capitalizing on Your Intellectual Property is the theme of this year's InventionCon 2021. InventionCon is an opportunity for you to learn from subject matter experts, business leaders, industry experts, and government officials about how to obtain your intellectual property, best practices while in businesses, and learn how to overcome challenges that others may have faced in either obtaining their intellectual property or going commercial. In addition, you may also find information about ways to join other programs such as the Manufacturing Extension Partnership with NIST or the Small Business Administration and what loans and grants are available. So it's an opportunity for you to learn about all the resources available through government and hear from those people who have gone through the process. At this time, I'd like to say thank you to everybody who's joined us today. It's been an exciting time for us to have you be part of our program. And in closing, I'd like to thank all of our speakers for being part of the program today. And again, all of our online participants for taking advantage of the wisdom, experience, and insight of these innovative leaders who have provided inspiration, encouragement, and resources to help us all be even more successful in our own journeys. If you missed any part of today's programs or want to revisit the discussions, the videos will be made available online at www.uspto.gov in the next few weeks. For all of those who registered for the program, I encourage you to take advantage of the resources offered from USPTO. We will be sending out a survey by email in the next day, and we welcome your feedback on the program today. We'd love to hear from you and find out more about what you'd like to see from our office in the future. Thank you for being a part of our program today, Proud Innovation, and we hope you'll join us on August 18th for InventionCon 2021. Thank you again, and we look forward to seeing you soon.